these figures when Vintage Solar has not been deployed that long? What kinds of deaths are there?
From what?
From solar?
From solar.
Fall off a roof.
What was your answer?
Fall off a roof.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I mean, it's just basic construction is mostly solar. And wind, I mean, same thing.
Well, by the same token, I'm sure there's industrial accidents and construction of a nuclear reactor.
But the important thing is deaths per terawatt hour, per unit of energy produced. And what the nuclear power plants produce is just prodigious amounts of electricity, whereas the solar does not produce very much. It's only a few hours a day. It's very low level energy. So, you know, when you look at it from that perspective, if we're trying to produce a lot of energy, and you multiply that out to, well, how many deaths is that going to result in? I mean, this is a good metric to use. You know, Fukushima, zero deaths. Chernobyl, it was less than 50. I mean, that's tragic, obviously, but it's not going to get any worse than Chernobyl.
But do you mean then that, for instance, the deaths from coal is in the process of mining the coal?
That's everything.
Everything.
Mining.
Breathing the air?
Breathing the air, oh, yes. Terrible. Oh, it's toxic effects of...
I'm suspicious of figures like that.
Well, I don't know where to come from. I'm just wondering, I mean, since the deaths from nuclear extend over such a long period of time, I mean, if there were a nuclear accident and they wouldn't know for 20 years if people were exposed, how could they come up with a definite?
That's part of the living or no threshold. You know, those, in fact, UNSCEAR, which they are the experts, they said you should not be using linear no threshold to project cancers into the future. And the way they describe that is if one person drinks 2 gallons of water in a city, that's lethal. You will die. What linear no threshold says is that if you take 2 gallons of water, split it up into pints, and have 16 people drink a pint of water, one of those 16 people is going to die.
From the water?
From the water. That's what linear no threshold says. It is simply not the way nature works. It's not the way biology works. Aspirin, you know, if you take two bottles of aspirin, all in one sitting, you're going to die. If you take two a day, it's good for your heart. And, you know, and similar for radiation. In the last 20 years, the medical community is actually, you know, they're discovering the biological mechanisms for DNA repair. And as it turns out, there's the body repairs DNA breaks all the time. The vast majority of DNA breaks are from oxidative activity from normal metabolic reactions. And a DNA break from radiation just pales in comparison to the number of normal breaks just from being alive, just normal body chemistry. And that's something we didn't know before. So,
what was the source of that? It looked different from that IPCC graph that was in the book. Of the deaths for each type of energy.
This one here?
Yeah. And I'm not sure that, like, is the whole full cycle included, like the uranium mining?
That's the question.
Mm-hmm. I'm not sure, but I've seen a lot of graphs with the deaths per terawatt hour, and you're right, Coralie, depending on the source, they're going to include some of those things a little differently. But as it turns out, the relative differences are just not there. So even if it's down in the realm of deaths by natural gas, that's still, I mean, And we, there are a lot of people die from natural gas. You read about it every day in the paper. But, you know, we're two orders of magnitude less than natural gas.
Or for instance, oil. I mean, they're not including oil wars in that.
No.
I can tell you it's a dangerous business. Very dangerous.
This drilling and like offshore drilling and that sort of thing.
And sometimes they drill offshore and they use the wrong blowout preventer and things explode.
Yeah.
The last one.
Gary, yeah. I'm wondering just how really, and I'm not arguing about it, I'm just wondering how comparable this really is, because you're looking at nuclear per death per terawatt.
Right.
Okay, one plant has an enormous number of terawatts. It's just one coal plant, for instance. But I'm not sure that's a bad cut for one plant as opposed to another plant. The numbers would be very different.
If your goal is to produce a lot of energy with minimal impact, this is something that people say, well, it's not safe. And, you know, if we power the, well, the last figure I saw is that globally, petroleum, fossil fuels, produce 86% of global energy. I mean, that's the thing you need to take a bite out of, you know. And that means it's coal, oil, and natural gas. So that's, you know, and it turns out that you can't expand hydro a whole lot more. We can get more out of it, but.
How about the beaches, the water coming into beaches all over the world? I mean, they can't harbor, they can't use it.
You're talking about tidal?
Tidal waves, tidal. Yeah, all the tidal things.
Tidal energy.
I mean, there's so little energy there, and there would be impacts to that too when you start putting all this machinery in a high salinity environment. I mean, in comparison to the total amount of energy that we need, there are going to be some applications of tidal, but we need everything we can to make it work. We need to learn the limitations. So,
well, this is a graph just to show the risk of extracting or producing, making that energy available. It's not like how many deaths would come from years of using the. Like nuclear would have probably be safe, but then to get rid of the waste, that's probably what most people are concerned about. And then coal and oil, the deaths that come from, well, for instance, all the children getting asthma. I mean, the groups because of the bad air, so there is going to be some deaths that they never probably put their hands in oil, but they're going to be deaths from breathing pollution. So this is just a graph to show producing the energy, right? It's not a graph showing what the ultimate cost of the energy. Okay.
Right. I think you bring up another point there,
yeah.
And that is that nuclear also makes it possible to develop nuclear weapons, and the risk of some kind of nuclear war, we're getting closer, and I mean, that has been a consistent risk, so I think that we would have to consider not just nuclear in general, but we would need to consider nuclear processes that do not allow the production of weapons-grade plutonium.
No, you're right. But again, that's one of those things that I think there's greater fear there than the evidence would support. I'm not downplaying the severity of nuclear war. But the reality is that there are 31 nations that operate nuclear power reactors. I mean, for electricity. There are 56 nations that have either nuclear power reactors or research reactors for production of medical isotopes, other things of that nature. There are 8 nations that had nuclear weapons. And Our best example is North Korea. Here is a country that cannot feed its own people. I've seen a night photo, you know, from orbit of North Korea and South Korea. North Korea is basically dark. South Korea is lit up like a Christmas tree. South Korea manufactures nuclear power plants for other countries. They've got a lot of nuclear. They're a highly industrialized nation. They don't have nuclear bombs. They make, it's a political decision. And, you know, the link between civilian nuclear power and nuclear weapons is very, very tenuous. Now, we still need to be concerned about proliferation. You know, there are safeguards in place. We need to tighten those up and stick with it. But the new generation of reactors that are being developed are going to be even more proliferation resistant. In other words, the materials that they use are completely unsuitable for weapons use. That's what we want.
Which kind of, I'm sorry, these are the fast reactors that you're talking about? Or is it something else?
That's one approach, is the fast reactor. The other approach are the thorium based molten salt reactors, where the radioactive components are actually dissolved in high temperature liquid, molten salt. And it's basically a soup of different components. And they, when they get the concentration right, it goes critical and produces heat. Well, you've got a mix of materials in there that is impossible to separate. There's no weapons grade anything.
But what is the actual chance, since they're not developing nuclear at all, and are they still researching this? Is there an actual chance that we could develop this instead of nuclear reactors that we're more familiar with that are now in existence?
There are a lot of companies working on these advanced designs. I mean, just in the U.S., there are 50 startups that are working on various different types of advanced nuclear reactors.
When you say startups, you mean they're actually building?
Companies.
Well,
no. In the U.S., you don't get to build anything unless you spend at least $500 million on permitting.
But in the world, how many of these next generation, are they the fourth, what they call the fourth generation?
Mm-hmm.
How many of these reactors are there actually being built or are there?
I know that Russia actually has at least two fast reactors. It's not quite the same. There's different ways to do fast neutron reactors, but they actually have two commercial scale electric power plants that are run by a fast reactor technology.
And I think Russia has a bad history of industrial accidents.
That's Russia.
Not just generally.
Right.
Gary, I might ask you a follow-up question. No, yes. Sue. I checked my old notes about our last discussion here on this. That was in 2012. And we discussed this, and one of the reasons why I decided not to support nuclear power was that the development of these new, safer reactors, non-plutonium reactors, was coming along very slowly. But thorium was being discussed and being researched and experimented with in 2012. Right. So the question I wanted to ask is, since then, and what is the progress? But that was Shelley's question just a minute ago. What's the progress about this? Are we close to finding a reactor that we do not have to fear nuclear weapons from? And if that should happen, then my attitude would be quite a bit different.
Well, I can give you one example of that. The company is called Thorcon, T-H-O-R-C-O-N, and it's a U.S.-based company, but they're going to Indonesia to build their thorium molten salt reactor because they know that it would take the way the Nuclear Regulatory Commission is set up now, it would take decades to get a non-light water reactor in a standard design through NRC approval. They don't want to wait that long.
So, but you could get a light water reactor through, but easier than you could a thorium salt reactor?
Absolutely, yeah.
Why?
Because the NRC doesn't have the staff, they don't have the resources, and a lot of the regulations are set up for light water reactors, and they require a lot of things that don't apply to a molten salt thorium reactor. And, you know, if you're looking at a startup company with a design, and they know that, okay, I've got to have $500 million or $1 billion just to get to where I maybe have an approved design, I mean, that's a heavy lift for any investor, just, you know, and then the time frame. So, but they would love to build it in this country, but they're going to Indonesia. They've got a memorandum of understanding, and Indonesia would be perfect because they've got thousands of islands, you know, and you can't have a connected grid. So they're burning diesel for a lot of their islands. And the Thorcon reactor would be completely built in a factory. In fact, their design is to use shipyard technology to build these reactors. These are computer controlled, high precision welding cranes. They manufacture to high precision in blocks, and they, you know, ship them to the site and weld them together in high quality control. And their whole philosophy is fast, simple, safe, inexpensive. You know, their business plan is capital cost and operating cost less than coal. And, you know, so it's companies like that that are going to change the game there. You know, that's, they see the problems. You know, they see climate change is a big problem, and they see the nuclear industry. Why the existing reactors are good, they're safe, they work. But if we want to handle, you know, solve the global problem, you know, they want to put a solution out there that's going to scale up. And so, in addition to their plant design for a molten salt reactor, part of their business plan is the factory. So for $2 billion, you build a shipyard factory dedicated to turning out these plants. And it would be capable of building 100 1-gigawatt reactors per year. And that's the kind of scale that we need if we're gonna, you know, take a bite out of the big energy chunk.
100 1-gigawatt fast thorium reactors, or thorium salt reactors per year. They could,
for one factory.
The company could build 100 of those a year.
Mm-hmm.
Could they use the salt from cleaning salt from the oceans? What do they call them?
Desalinization.
Desalinization.
It's different salts.
It's a different salt.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Fluoride salts.
Okay.
Probably chloride. I mean, it's
different
salts.
Gary, that's a question.
Oh, one time. When we go to Europe, we stay with a family, and there are 6 adults. 5 of them are mega scientists. They're all working on their PhDs, or they have their PhDs. And the other adult is a woman, and she's French. These people love the idea of nuclear. And father worked for the European Union. He was a senior guy with the European Union. But they say one of their advantages, and I'm not talking about technical advantages, but one of their advantages over there is psychological. Their kids learn from day one that global warming is real. They use the Scandinavian countries as their model, not only for their governments, but for their science and everything. And So they have political will and the will of the people. And they where they work, they represent France, Germany, Spain, and Switzerland. I mean, they have all those perspectives. What would be the best argument for this here? Because you're right, a lot of people are of the 50s mindset, remember, duck and cover, oh, God, you know, everything's best and happen. What would be the best way to approach it? All your arguments that you have, that you've given us today, which is the one that you think is the most compelling? Because in the very end, it's going to be the taxpayers and the voters' decision as to what they will accept and what they want. What's the most compelling argument that you think of all of this that you've given us?
For co-nuclears?
Yep.
I mean, what technology, or just what is the best reason
What's
to
the
go
best
for
it? Reason to go for it. You know, you got to talk about people who are eating Cheetos and watching a big screen TV.
Right.
What's the best
you know,
reason? Because I know in your opinion,
there's a lot of debate about that, and everybody's got a different opinion. My opinion is that it's going to be difficult to overcome the obstacles on the social end and even on the political end, because there's just so many conflicts of interest, misunderstanding, the time, the years go by. It's going to be made on a strictly financial, economic basis. And that's why this company like Thorcon, and others have that idea too, is unless we get a technology that will deliver reliable energy for developed and developing nations with a capital cost and operating cost less than coal, when you get to that point, it's a done deal. You know, you won't have to change people's minds. All of a sudden, it's just, everything's going to change, you know, because it's going to be less expensive. And that's what's going to drive the wholesale change, I think.
Europe seems to be sharply divided, because 80% of the people in Germany say they want to go to the economy. And Italy is, and there's several other European countries. I think maybe Austria.
They
has a lot of neighbors.
But, I mean, France
is going to
sit dinner across the table from them, and this is the way they see the future. But, I mean, they really big on win, but it depends on country, how much sun do we get, what are the wind patterns going on. They understand that, but they realize that global warming is the biggest threat to their lives, because it brings out off terrorism, droughts in Syria, why do you think these people are leaving? They understand its connection to terrorism and stuff like that. They have a broader picture. And I the last wedding we went to, everybody and his mother was an engineer or some kind of nuclear scientist or whatever. And they're just swearing up. So, I mean, I don't know where you're getting your statistics, and they may very well be right. But they are very excited about it. And because all of it, and the more they have children, the more excited they get. Because they know, they can see the human on the
Well, I'm sure the people in Germany and Italy and us Austrians and whatever also worry about climate change, because among other things, if the Gulf Stream changes,
I guess that this energy won't be able to solve our problem with petroleum, though, because how can nuclear energy?
It's also process heat. In fact, there's another class of nuclear reactor that's called a high temperature gas reactor. And it will use, typically I think it's helium gas as the heat transfer mechanism, but the reaction itself will actually be much hotter than you can get from our current reactors. So some industrial process requires really high level heat. And so there are some types of reactors that can provide that as well.
Concentrating solar, if you did it, I did.
It's a nice thought, but when you think about the investment that goes into any industrial plant, they want that plant running 24/7. And, you know, the concentrated solar plants that have been built so far, their performance has been extremely disappointing. They look great, but they are performing way below their intended capacity factor. And they are totally dependent on natural gas, because when the sun goes down, you have to heat the molten salt as part of their heat transfer medium. You have to keep it hot, otherwise it solidifies. So these things are burning natural gas all the time when the sun is not out. So it's, you know.
I don't know if you have more slides you want to get on to later, but oh, okay.
We're open for questions, okay. And we're doing a great job.
I was interested in disposal of waste.
Okay.
Because that, unless you did that before I got
no,
here.
No. Okay. That's a great topic. In fact, it's almost kind of a joke, or it's well known in the pro-nuclear community that when you're talking with the general public, invariably the first question comes up is, yeah, well, what about the waste? I mean, it really is true. So, and the best way I can start on that is I know a nuclear engineer, a young woman, who works for NuScale, which they're the company that's trying to make these small modular reactors that are probably the first new design that comes out of the NRC. So her job is to, she goes all over the place talking to potential clients, and she's sort of public relations. But what she said,